Hello, greetings, and welcome, my dear listeners. My name is Heretical Hatter, and I welcome you to this second episode of my little project named Tau Empire Reimagined. Last time, we were talking about anatomy of a Tau race, and today, we will move to the castes of a Tau society and the differences between them. Let's start with the fire caste. Fire caste comes from the deserts and steppes of a Tau homeworld, where they operated as nomads, creating small towns and villages around oases. For the most part, they were hunters and shepherds. The culture of hunter cadres comes from this era, as relatively small groups of hunters would move independently or as dispersed united force to ensure the greatest efficiency in hunting. Fire caste were beast riders, and despite their generally more aggressive nature compared to many other kin, they had also a good ability to tame aggressive animals of their home world. In terms of physical differences, the fire caste has greater reaction speed, stamina, and strength compared to most other castes. What is also interesting is that their sense of smell is marginally different from other castes, as members of a fire caste have greater ability to detect smells from further distance, an adaptation most likely connected to their hunting culture. Another interesting idea I came up with is that fire castes' hoofs are a bit wider and slightly softer compared to other castes, allowing them to move silently over the steppes and plains of their homeworld, without making much of a sound. Each caste possesses their own subculture, and fire caste is no different in this regard, having many unique and strange traditions. I had a little bit of fun with this one, so I hope you will enjoy my take on the fire caste culture. The greatest difference of all is the name. Name isn't something which is given by parents. It is something which is earned. A young child is only known as son or daughter of this and this parent. It is through deeds that fire caste gain names. Usually people with longer names are seen as more heroic and talented compared to others. Of course, there is a limited number of names one can come up with. As such, the greater the accomplishments, the longer the name, the more unique the fire caste becomes. Another part of fire caste culture are scars and tattoos, with deeds, loyalty to the sept or tribe in the ancient times. Symbols are cut into the flesh of a fire caste or burned with hot iron. It is part of their tradition that survives to this day. Some septs prefer to use tattoos in modern era, but many still use blades to carve the symbol of their home and oaths of loyalty and devotion into their own flesh. Another tradition which survived and even spread in modern era is connected to the process of rising through ranks in the modern society. It's known as Trial of Fire, a test to a given Tau so they can be tested if they are worthy to rise in ranks and hierarchy of a society. The tests can be anything, except elders aside. In some cases, the test isn't even needed, as a given firecast achieved some great victory, and this alone gave them right to rise in ranks. In modern era, it can be some dangerous simulation to test one's character and ability. In ages past, it could be a solo hunt, a scout mission to the hostile tribe, or maybe even being a leader of a hunting party to test the ability of a hunter, not only as a killer, but as a leader. To this very day, a symbolic walk through fire has been incorporated into traditions of the modern Sept worlds. It is meant to symbolize the passing through the challenge and advancing to the new rank. This system of trials has been implemented by the entire Tau society. Every 4 years, there is an option to go through the trial if a given Tau wishes to advance through ranks. Although, as one could suspect, the trial of fire is still quite dangerous and exclusive to a firecast. Another interesting difference between firecast and their cousins is the importance of family. When communal raising of children was typical for the most of the Tau society even before the new unification, for the firecast, the family, the individual parents, the individual bloodlines were always very important. This tradition is most likely connected to the names among the firecast. As firecast was recognized as child of individuals rather than a tribe. In modern era, ethereals managed to suppress these traditions, but not as much as they would like to. Another very important part of firecast culture is respect to other predators and the prey. They were always trained to respect the environment, their targets, and their enemies. As such, firecast has no problem using weapons, tactics, and ideas of their foes, while at the same time showing respect to their enemies. One of such examples is tradition that a dying enemy shouldn't be dying thirsty. Even in modern era, if foe was worthy and honorable, the Tau will either try to save their lives and take their prisoners, or share water with them in their last moments. This might be connected to other ancient traditions, as members of Firecast believed that not a single piece of a hunted prey or downed enemy should be wasted. And that's because, unlike many other races in the galaxy, the Firecast and Tau in general believe that a spirit of animal and sapient person are just as strong, are equal, and the spirit of animal can be just as vengeful as spirit of a person. That's why Firecast shows respect to their foes and the animals they kill. For example, they take care of the young if they killed their mother. They ensure that every piece of their prey, of the bounty they hunted, is used well, as this is the duty of a hunter to the prey. The same is on a battlefield. The Tau will respect and use every bit of experience they gain during the battle, because that's a duty of a warrior to a warrior. This might be why the Firecast doesn't like to shoot at medics, and why many times they return the bodies of the fallen to their enemies, or why they are quite okay with Krut eating their enemies. After all, their traditions match in this regard. Now that we finished talking about Firecast, let's talk about the Earthcast. The Earthcast come from riverbanks and shores of the planet. Those rich and bountiful regions of their world where civilization thrived. They were the first city builders, the farmers, the builders of the Tau civilization. The Earthcast are smaller compared to other Tau, probably because of smaller amount of meat in their diet. However, they can rival Firecast in regards of stamina and are much tougher than other castes. Members of the Earthcast are just like the things they build. They are made to last. They aren't as fast or as strong, but they are resilient and tenacious if they want to. They also display impressive ability to problem solve. There is no challenge too great or too complex tool for them to develop. They will create and build everything to make living easier for everyone. The Tau civilization is built upon the backs of the Earthcast. It was them who built the first great cities, who tamed the land and water. However, what is the most interesting about Earthcast creations is that they are interconnected with nature. The Earthcast have a natural ability to understand their environment and how to work with it rather than against it. Concepts such as harmony, balance, and healing are the most important to the Earthcast. In the harsh and arid environment of their home, exploitation of the soil wasn't an option. Where land was exploited, civilizations died. There was no fighting against the planet itself. Members of Earthcast usually gain their names through their craft. Unlike the Firecast, the Earthcast had communal families. It was community which raised children, not an individual family. And the greater Earthcast society was, and still is, split by the specialization in craft. And by the specialization, one gained names. The tradition of raising children as community comes from Earthcast. What is also important to note is that Earthcast never were and aren't pacifists. They weren't as good in fighting as the Firecast, and that's why they built walled cities and castles. Because if you have advantage in the tech tree, a bunch of nomads ain't gonna breach your fancy stone walls. But they can still try to starve you out. So Earthcast were and still are quite familiar with idea of war and fighting, although in modern age it is on the far smaller scale. Earthcast isn't expected to fight on the front lines, but they are part of every military campaign. They take on roles of medics, engineers, and logisticians, mostly in the back lines. But it isn't unheard for some Earthcast to venture all the way to the front. They are also essential in training of combat medics and combat engineers of the Firecast. Indeed, it is Earthcast, not Firecast, which trains future frontline medics and engineers in their most specific craft. Sure, veterans of the old campaigns are useful and can teach quite a lot, but the basics and greater understanding of a craft can be only given by true masters, and they can be only found among the Earthcast. In the age before unification, the Earthcast and Firecast were bitter rivals. In some ways, they still are, but both groups fully understand their role in the greater good. It is Firecast who fight to protect and expand the territory, but it is on the backs of Earthcast on which entire empire is built upon. And one can see this pride of the Earthcast in their art. They usually create statues and paintings which are popular among other castes and praise the glory of a greater good. And Earthcast will be always sure that everyone knows who created what piece of art. The next cast we will discuss is Watercast. The Watercast comes from shores and numerous islands of their home world. In the age before unification, they were the greatest sailors and traders of the world, traveling far and wide throughout their homeworld. In terms of biological differences, Watercast is a bit taller than their cousins, which makes sense because members of the Watercast have much greater lung capacity compared to other Tau. An evolutionary adaptation most likely, as Watercast are great divers. Something which isn't fully understood by neither the Tau or the humans is that members of Watercast seem more attractive compared to other Tau, both to the members of their own race and other species. Some believe that the pheromones of the Watercast are a bit different to the other members of their species, giving them natural ability to influence other races and the members of their own species. What is the most interesting about the Watercast, however, is that they are most expressive of a Tau race. They are far more expressive with their mimicry and gesticulation, as well as tone of voice, compared to other castes. The reason for those changes are suspected to be connected to the problems with smell-based communication on water. Tau pheromones naturally are drawn to humid places, like the big nostril on the Tau forehead, which explains that humid and water environment makes the communication by pheromones far less effective. The Watercast were always traders and diplomats. They were never as numerous as other castes, but they were always more adept in figuring out what other people think and what they want. As such, many times they acted not only as traders or messengers, but as schemers before the age of unification. That's how Watercast survived and thrived in the dangerous world before unification. By manipulation and bribery, they gained power, influence, and their place on the homeworld. After all, why fight if you can pay others to do this for you? The need to gather information also forced Watercast to travel, and to this day travel is most natural part of Watercast life. This is also how their philosophical way of thinking and looking at the world came to be. Many of their number were scholars who gathered information about different cultures from their entire planet just to know how to use all every of those cultures to their own benefit. You see, the islands that were populated by the Watercast had very limited resources. As such, Watercast developed very advanced administration skills just to know what to buy, what they need, and what they can trade to get what they need. Negotiations, diplomacy, trading, it wasn't just a way of life for Watercast, it was the only way they could survive and thrive on their world. To this very day, Watercast are diplomats, negotiators and traders of a Tau race. And just as in the ages long past, they still gather information, they study cultures, and they find weaknesses and cracks which can be exploited in the name of greater good. In terms of other traditions, the Watercast are the greatest artists of a Tau race. While other castes have their individual culture and art styles, it is Watercast that are the best at it among all of Tau. The greatest form of art for Watercast, however, is cliff or storm singing. The edge of a cliff, or on the beach, or during a storm, a member of a Watercast sings a melody that is supposed to be a choir of nature itself. The greatest of those singers don't need instruments, as the nature itself is the orchestra for their song. A tradition born from the need for long-range communication on the sea, and as we all know, songs and sound carry far on the waves. And so, from pragmatic need, a form of art was born, and it is quite alive and well to this very day. The Watercast is also known for their tattoos. When Firecast cuts symbols of loyalty into their skin or burn them into it with hot iron, the Watercast use tattoos to show their devotion. Most usually, ink found in different species overseas was used to create tattoos. The most valuable type of tattoo, however, is made of special fluorescent algae which can be found on the Tau homeworld. This algae enters a symbiotic relationship with a Watercast, creating beautiful patterns on their skin, growing and growing throughout their life. Many members of the Watercast continue this tradition to this very day. And here it is. The Watercast, the artists, the diplomats, the traders, the schemers of a Tau race. Those who can smooth out any argument or start one out of nothing, if there is a need for it. Phew! 3 out of 5. Let's keep this going! So, who is next on the chopping block? The Aircast. So, the Aircast come from the mountains and the hills of the Tau homeworld. A most bizarre of all castes, even compared to the Ethereals. The greatest difference between the Aircast and the other members of the Tau species is that they have hollow bones, which is quite interesting and weird, as this doesn't seem to be part of natural evolution, but rather something caused by a virus or an infection. And I think there is an easy explanation. You see, the Earth and the Tau aren't really similar planets. I think that it would be reasonable to assume that because Tau are a bit weaker physically, they have weaker gravity on their homeworld. Let's say around 10 or 15% smaller. How that came to be is your choice. You can say that Tau as a planet is simply smaller, or maybe it's bigger but has same density as Earth. Both would cause the planet to have smaller gravity compared to Earth. The lower gravity would explain why the Tau managed to reach the stars so quickly. After all, weaker gravity means much easier creation of flying machines and going up to orbit. The same thing, however, would mean that giant flying creatures would have a chance to evolve and thrive on the Tau world. And I think we both know where I'm going with this. Oh yeah. I want Tau Aircast to be a goddamn Dragon Raiders. I can do what I want, this is my rewrite. And guess what? Those massive flying creatures might be the explanation how the Tau Aircast have hollow bones. After all, there are viruses which are carried only by animals, but they can pass to, for example, humans. Why such a thing wouldn't happen among the Tau? So, this is my explanation. By taming and interacting with those flying creatures, the aircast of the Tau got infected by a virus which caused a change in their genetic code and caused that their bones became hollow. And you must understand that for them it was a blessing and a curse at the same time. After all, breaking a bone if your bone is hollow is far more problematic. On the other hand, you weigh less, so climbing and travel on top of mountains and the great beasts is far easier. With that, other adaptations followed, like the fact that aircasts have far greater ability to balance themselves and comprehend three-dimensional space and travel in three dimensions in air, almost as it was their other sense. Compared to every other cast, they have also the greatest reaction speed, and their eyes dilate far faster than any other cast, and in some examples, even faster than humans. How that came to be isn't fully understood. Could be a natural evolution or another strange mutation brought by interacting with the flying beasts of their home world. Because of dangers of avalanches and predators of the mountains, the aircast is also far more quiet and stoic compared even to other Tau. They speak softly and quietly. Their pheromones also changed, making them a bit harder to understand for other castes. Despite that, they were crucial in the long-range communications. The aircasts were messengers and traders, or rather, they worked for watercast traders, delivering supplies where they were needed. Little is known of aircast traditions and art, outside the fact that they still tame the flying beasts, and many septs see this act as a sign of adulthood among the young members of the aircast. As for art, it seems that they prefer a sand art, where one creates beautiful imagery through colored sand and then destroy it with one move. From where this tradition came from isn't known, or why it is practiced to this day. But it reflects on aircast culture quite well, as they don't care about the riches, they don't care about the glory. They only care that they are part of something greater, even if just for a moment. In modern age, the aircast still are quiet and reliable rulers of the sky. They are known of their quiet nature and habitats in orbit, where they moved after Tau started to conquering the void itself. They are silent, unseen, and many times misunderstood. But they don't see to mind. The aircast are as stoic as the mountains. However, don't let their quiet nature fool you, my dear listener. For if their facade cracks and they show you their rage, it is like an avalanche. It is said that the most bloodthirsty of a Firecast can never hope to compare themselves to seemingly endless rage of an Aircast. Fans of Imperium of Man like to joke that the Tau shake in fear when the churches start walking, but I assure you, the walking churches will tremble when the mountains start to walk towards them. Well, here we are, the last cast to talk about the Ethereals. They are, without a doubt, the most mysterious of all castes. They showed up without a warning or explanation, with amazing ability to manipulate with the help of their far more potent pheromones compared to any other caste. They can bring peace of mind and keep anyone's attention by their presence alone. Physically, they aren't neither stronger, faster, or even that much smarter than other castes. However, there is one main physical difference to all other Tau. The Ethereals have strange crystal in their forehead connected to their singular nostril. By the studies of Xenorites of the Adeptus Mechanicus, it seems that this crystal formation is somehow connected to the ability of spreading pheromones, but also cancelling their influence. How this works is a complete mystery, just as their culture, traditions, or even how they raise their children isn't known. A few things which are known is a strange art of meditation and melee fighting, which is bizarre for a Tau. Yet the Ethereals seem to practice this strange form of martial art most of their free time. Their traditions regarding naming the children or how they work within their own structure is a complete mystery. They are also the least numerous caste, their numbers not exceeding 2% of total Tau population. What is very interesting, however, is that Ethereals live far longer than any other Tau. Their natural lifespan can reach even 300 years, and with technology, it can be even more expanded. How such thing is possible isn't truly understood. Even Xenorites of Adeptus Mechanicus aren't fully sure why the Tau Ethereals seem to have far greater lifespan compared to their cousins. The truth is a mystery. By all accounts, however, Ethereals seem almost to be designed to be unifiers and leaders of a Tau race. While sharing many characteristics with other castes, they are also quite different. One can only guess their origins and their true nature. You really should have seen this one coming. You've been tricked, you've been backstabbed, and you were quite possibly bamboozled. Oh yeah, I'm going there. Because it doesn't make sense, but while there were quite distinctive populations on the Tau homeworld, that they were the only ones. I mean, having only 4 nations on the entire planet? Not really realistic. And this is my answer to that. But yes, there were mixed-blooded among the Tau in the ages past. They had many names. The Stone Cast, the Gold Cast, the Iron Cast. Call them whatever you want. Before unification, they were relatively common sight. After all, different societies did mix, and it's natural for this to happen among the Tau as well. The Tau of mixed blood seems to be stronger, better, and in many ways had stronger lifespans compared to their cousins. Another characteristic of a mixed-blooded was that they were quite resilient to Ethereal's pheromones, and this alone doomed them. They were a danger to Ethereal's authority. Their resistance to pheromones could lead to a disaster. As such, in the name of greater good and unification of the Tau race, they were wiped out of existence. Every single one. This was no culling of Thunder Warriors. There was no warning. They were dragged out of their homes and slaughtered by their friends, by their families, one by one. Unity had a price, and it was paid in the blood of a mixed Tau. However, fate is a fickle thing, isn't it? Sword of Destiny is a sharp blade, and once released, it falls quite fast upon the necks of the wicked. A threat once extinguished returned to the galaxy. On the worlds of the traitor to the greater good, in the far side enclaves, mixed-blooded Tau have returned. The Ethereals call them mixed-blooded. They call them impure. They, however, call themselves full-blooded, as they carry blood of the entire race. What will be their fate in this new, dangerous galaxy? Well, you will have to wait and listen well to find out. Welp, this was a bit longer than I expected, so I think we will end it here. I am aware that I promised to talk about myths of Tau society and the typical life of a Tau, however, I think we were here long enough. So hey, second episode done. Thank you for joining me on this little adventure, and I hope you will join me in the next episode. Ta-ta, my darlings!